Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Language and Mediated Masculinities, Cultures, Contexts, Constraints, by Robert Lawson. Narrated by David DeVries. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. Before the main part of the book, there are a few things I'd like to get out of the way first, primarily to help explain some of the background to the book and the actual process of writing it. These issues aren't central to the main aims of the book, but I think they're important in terms of the context in which it was written. If you prefer, you can skip over this preface and I'll be none the wiser. But as I go on to note, both here and in the upcoming chapters, this book is a product of who I am and the life I've lived, and the process of writing it is not divorced from that reality. To that end, this preface will give listeners a better understanding of how this book came about and how it is situated within the broader structural context of academia. First, writing this book has been, without a shadow of a doubt, the single most difficult personal and intellectual endeavor I've ever undertaken. Not only did I write the vast majority of the book during a prolonged period away from my family and friends as a junior visiting professor at the University of Uvascula, a point I discuss in more detail later on, but there is also a profound pressure in coming up with new ideas, seeing things in different ways, and ultimately writing something that other people are hopefully going to find a valuable, interesting, and useful contribution to knowledge. And since I don't consider myself especially talented, innovative, or clever, it's been doubly awful, because I've had to contend with constantly comparing myself to the brilliant writing that I have had to read for this book, and having an acute case of imposter syndrome doesn't help with this. Theodore Roosevelt once opined that comparison is the thief of joy. Yet comparison looms large in academia, where ideas are currency, and setting yourself out as different is an occupational necessity. So, to anyone listening to this who thinks that writing a book is easy, please take it from me that it's anything but. On the other hand, I don't think I'm anything special, so if I can do it, then you definitely can do it too. One thing that kept me going through the long days, nights, and weekends of writing was something that my parents told me when I was growing up. As long as you try your best, then no one can ask any more of you. This book is absolutely the best that I could have done. I hope it's enough. Second, over the course of writing this book, the UK higher education sector was embroiled in strike action in November 2019, February 2020, December 2021, and again in November 2022, partly in response to planned changes to pensions and partly in response to increasing precarity, workplace stress, and the yawning gap between education as a commodity and education as a social good. The strikes were not one-issue campaigns, but rather responses to the culmination of years of underinvestment, overwork, and a series of increasingly unrealistic demands on staff. After years of mismanagement by governmental agencies and ministers who variously introduced a variety of innovations like the National Student Survey, the Teaching Excellence Framework, and other metrics, academics across the UK decided that they could no longer tolerate the slow erosion of the values and expertise that has made the UK higher education sector one of the best in the world. While there's an argument to be made that the innovations introduced by government agencies encourage a high-quality teaching environment, the other side of the argument is that they detract from the core university focus of teaching, research, and writing, leading to short-term thinking couched primarily in terms of league tables and rankings. Moreover, academics are increasingly squeezed on all sides, barely able to keep up with the demands of teaching, planning, preparation, committees, meetings, marking, tutorials, office hours, emails, outreach, and public engagement, never mind reviewing, writing, editing, collaborating, and dealing with other research-related activities. These constant pressures have an effect on staff morale, mental health, and well-being, sometimes culminating in devastating consequences. The suicide of Dr. Malcolm Anderson, a lecturer at Cardiff University in February 2018, is one such tragedy. And there are countless others struggling under unsustainable workloads, unrealistic targets, constant emails, and the difficulties of doing more with less, leading to significant increases in depression, anxiety, and general poor mental health across the sector. The COVID-19 pandemic further exacerbated long-standing pressures, alongside the emotional and psychological toll of lockdowns, quarantines, virus testing, and isolation from friends, family, and colleagues. Don't get me wrong, I'm incredibly privileged to have the job that I do. I love working with my students and helping them reach their goals. My colleagues, both at BCU and further afield, are wonderful educators and incredible researchers, and I am proud to work alongside them. I find research tough, but I get a fair amount of personal and professional satisfaction from seeing an idea through to final publication. I have reasonable job security, I'm able to take on projects that I believe in, and I think that what I do as a teacher, lecturer, and researcher is socially valuable and adds something to the world, however small that contribution might be. Unfortunately, I know of far too many exceptionally talented colleagues who do amazing and important teaching and research on precarious fractional contracts, who have to jump from job to job with no long-term security, and who are not able to plan for their futures. I also know of too many colleagues who, even with secure contracts, find it difficult to keep up with the range of competing demands placed upon them. Academia certainly isn't the only sector suffering from these issues, reproduced as they are in healthcare, policing, transport, primary and secondary education, social work, and many other professions. While it's difficult to ward off the temptation to argue about who's got it worse, it's important that people stand together and push for real change across all sectors rather than engage in a race to the bottom. All of this takes me to my third point, which concerns the junior visiting professor post I took at the University of Uvascula, or JYU. As I mentioned earlier, writing this book was far from easy, most particularly because I lived apart from my wife Rebecca and our daughter Bethany for the 6 months of my research leave in Finland. There were a few reasons for making this decision. First, it didn't seem like a great idea to uproot the entire family and move to a country where we didn't know anyone, didn't speak the language, didn't know our way around, and didn't know if we'd make it through the long, dark months of a Finnish winter. Second, we knew that without accepting the post, writing this book would have to happen in the small chunks of time I had between meetings, teaching, commuting, and my regular work responsibilities, alongside spending evenings and weekends trying to make progress, something which didn't really appeal to either of us. Deciding whether or not to the opportunity on offer from JYU was one of the most difficult decisions Rebecca and I have ever had to make together, especially since the longest we'd been apart from one another in nearly 10 years was just over a week. In terms of positives, the post would mean that I would have nearly 6 months to dedicate to the book, alongside the opportunity to share my research and build new connections with an academic community I hadn't previously had the chance to work with. In terms of negatives, it meant that Rebecca would have to take on 6 months of looking after our daughter by herself, a full-time job substantially tougher than what I had to deal with in Finland, while we would be apart as a family for the duration of my stay. The personal cost for all of us should be obvious at this point. I say all of this because it's easy to be critical of someone who has upped sticks to gallivant off to another country for research purposes. For example, in one of the few academic articles on acknowledgments, Kalachi observes that they offer a glimpse into the political economy of academic life, revealing truths that we intend to share as well as many that we do not. Kalachi goes on to wryly note that acknowledgments written by male scholars sometimes seem to blur the boundary between a genuine thank you letter and a heartfelt confessional, suggesting the following as a more accurate rendering of traditional acknowledgments. Dear reader, I exploited my wife's reproductive labor, neglected my children and aging parents, shifted departmental service onto my colleagues, extracted knowledge from people in a distant country, contributed to the warming of the planet by flying all over the world, and withdrew from my community, all in order to bring you this book. I read Kalachi's article about halfway through writing the book, and it has stayed with me ever since, especially because, at least in my case, there was more than the sting of truth in her argument. Support of my wife? Check. Leaving her to take on all the child-caring duties? Check. Spending time away from my daughter? Check. Leaving colleagues to take on my work responsibilities? Check. Traveling via airplane to a far-flung international locale? Check. Didn't see family or friends for months? Check. I fit, in quite a worrying way, it has to be said, what Kalachi calls, mostly tongue-in-cheek, I think, the ideal scholar, one who is flexible, mobile, has a passport from a powerful nation, can rely on a partner for childcare, and is not providing for extended family or elderly, sick, or vulnerable parents. It is true that I have benefited enormously from the privilege of international mobility, the invitation of a research post at a prestigious international institution, and the support of my wife, who took on the individual responsibility of raising our daughter while working at a university which allowed me to take time away from my normal duties and having colleagues who could cover my responsibilities. While all of this is perhaps commonplace in academia, especially for male scholars, it nevertheless raises a number of issues concerning equality of opportunity, privilege, and reciprocity. I could, of course, overlook all of this and instead present the writing of this book as the neat, packaged-up story that we all know and love. And this is Kalachi's argument. Most people do exactly that, a process which simply erases the structural contexts and struggles within which academic work emerges. By confronting some of these issues, we can at least start to ask the question, as Kalachi does, was this book really worth it? And doing so requires us to deal with some of the less salutary aspects of academic life, and to consider some of the broader structural contexts of academia, which Kalachi's main thesis arguably overlooks. This ultimately takes me to my fourth and final point. I think it's something of an open secret to say that academia is a ridiculously competitive club. There is a constant need to be research active and to climb the greasy ladder of something called success. Ultimately, research outputs in the form of journal articles, books, edited volumes, chapters, and so on are worth something in the eyes of the academy and in the eyes of the institutions who employ you. In the precarious and shifting sands of higher education, publications influence promotions, confer status, and often determine job security. Failure to publish can raise questions about your performance, your competency, and your ability to conduct research, so the pressure is on to write. But how do you fit something as demanding as a book alongside all of the other responsibilities that one might have? Unfortunately, with great difficulty. While the earliest rumblings of this book go all the way back to 2013, I eventually started working on it in earnest during my research leave in late 2018, where I was able to complete rough drafts of every chapter by the time my sabbatical ended. From January 2019 to August 2019, I didn't have any time for the book at all due to major structural changes at BCU, preparing for teaching new modules, plus a host of other day-to-day activities that I needed to do just to keep my head above water. From January 2014 until January 2020, I oversaw the entire English degree program as part of my job at BCU, so it was a very intense and student-focused role. In 2018, I also took the decision to limit the amount I worked at evenings and weekends in order to spend time with my family, rather than working the 50 or 60-hour weeks that I had been previously. So it wasn't until I arrived at JYU in August 2019 that I was able to make any significant headway on the book, where I had time to read, learn new methods, analyze data, and write almost every day, including weekends, for nearly 6 months straight. And it was time that I needed. To go back to the post at JYU, the question Rebecca and I kept returning to was a simple one. Could we afford to turn it down? Without taking the post, the likely publication of this book would have been closer to 2026. As it is, it's out in 2023, a full 3 years earlier, and hopefully much closer to the contemporary contexts I discuss in the different chapters. I am nevertheless conscious of the extra work that Rebecca took on to make the visit to Finland, and by extension the book, possible in the first place. FaceTime, Skype, and pictures helped with the loneliness we both felt, but it's never quite the same as being in the there and now. The guilt of being an absent husband and father, knowing that I was missing out on precious time with my daughter and my wife, is not an experience I'd ever like to go through again. But as Rebecca reminded me during one evening of soul-searching, opportunities like visiting professor posts, junior or otherwise, very rarely come along, and it would have been silly to have turned it down. I'd certainly be the first to acknowledge that my privilege made it possible for me to finish this book, but I think it's reasonable to say that this is only part of the story. To that end, I hope what I've covered in this preface has provided more of an insight into the personal and professional contexts within which this book has been written. This kind of openness is much needed in academia, even if it is scary to stick your head above the parapet. Chapter 1. Contexts, Cultures, and Constraints. Language and Mediated Masculinities in the 21st Century. Trump, Pussygate, and Contemporary Masculinities. In late 2016, The Washington Post released a video of presidential candidate Donald Trump and Access Hollywood host Billy Bush discussing women, dating, and relationships. Captured during a bus ride while both Trump and Bush's microphones were switched on, this conversation saw Trump brag about his fame, his wealth, and his attempts at having sex with a married woman, offering a candid insight into his views regarding his celebrity status, the construction of sexual privilege, and his objectification of women. As the bus stops, one moment in the conversation stands out, where Trump and Bush start talking about the host who is meeting them, Arianne Zucker, an actress and model best known for her role in the American soap opera Days of Our Lives. 1. Trump. Yeah, that's her with the gold. I better use some Tic Tacs just in case I start kissing her. You know I'm automatically attracted to beautiful... I just start kissing them. 5. It's like a magnet. Just kiss. I don't even wait. And when you're a star, they let you do it. You can do anything. 10. Bush. Whatever you want. Trump. Grab them by the pussy. You can do anything. Bush. Yeah, those legs. All I can see is the legs. 15. Trump. It looks good. Bush. Come on, shorty. Trump. Oh, nice legs, huh? Bush. Get out of the way, honey. Oh, that's good legs. After identifying Zucker, Trump says that he should take some breath fresheners just in case he starts kissing her, before talking about how being a celebrity means that he can do anything he wants to women, even grab them by the pussy, line 11. In the process of reducing Zucker to her physical appearance, lines 7 through 11, coupled with comments about grabbing and kissing, Trump and Bush appear to condone sexual assault, abuse, and groping, ignoring issues of mutual consent and appropriate professional conduct. See also Cameron 2020 for a more detailed discussion of this incident. The video, originally recorded in 2005 but released in the run-up to the second presidential debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, drew criticism from across the social and political spectrum. House Speaker Paul Ryan stated that women should be championed or revered, not objectified, while John Oliver, host of the late-night political satire show Last Week Tonight, called Trump one giant, salivating, dick-size-referencing, pussy-grabbing warthog in a red power tie. On the other side of the pond, controversial public commentator Katie Hopkins argued that Trump is a very flawed human. Big deal. I'd rather be grabbed by the pussy than governed by one. In subsequent interviews, Trump defended his statement, arguing that it was locker room banter typical of the kind carried out by men in private settings where they brag about their sexual activities and their sexual partners. But even this generated widespread disagreement, especially among athletes, coaches, and other sporting professionals. For example, NFL player Chris Conley tweeted, "Just for reference, I work in a locker room every day. That is not locker room talk." While NBA player Kendall Marshall announced, "PSA, sexual advances without consent is not locker room talk." The video not only reignited debates about sexual privilege, consent, and how men in positions of power exploit their status, it also raised broader questions about men and masculinities in the 21st century, captured most prominently in ex-boxer Floyd Mayweather's defense of Trump, who argued that Trump speak like a real man spoke. Real men speak like, "Man, she had a fat ass. You see her ass? I had to squeeze her ass." Did the video really represent how men talk to one another in private? Were Trump and Bush men simply guilty of being men? And how did their conversation map on to cultural expectations surrounding white masculinity in contemporary Western societies? These questions once again came to the fore less than a year later during the hashtag MeToo movement, a social media campaign which sought to highlight the sexual abuse and harassment faced by women from all walks of life, including politics, academia, and the media and entertainment industries. Men and masculinities in the public eye. We have seen an increase in Western media coverage about bad men in recent years, with social commentators, politicians, and journalists critiquing, challenging, or contesting toxic masculinity, the age of aggressive masculinity, and the problem of men. A cursory look at the discourses of and about men, particularly white heterosexual men, the focus of this book, would suggest that they play a major role in almost every contemporary social problem, from climate change to the global financial crash, from wars and civil conflicts to inner-city crime, and from interpersonal domestic violence to mass shootings. And there is arguably some truth in this. For example, all of the mass shootings in the U.S. between 2000 and 2018 were carried out by men, many very often preceded by a history of domestic abuse and misogyny. Internationally, most violent crime is carried out by men, including attempted murder, rape, sexual assault, robbery, and terrorist offenses. Most institutional and workplace sexism is carried out by men. Most instances of domestic violence and assault are perpetrated by men. Those responsible for the global economic turndown and the subsequent financial scandals which followed, including the bankruptcy of Lehman Brothers Investment Bank in 2008, the renationalization of the Royal Bank of Scotland in 2009, the Lieber case in 2012, the J.P. Morgan Chase trading loss in 2014, the HBOS fraud case in 2016, and the HSBC tax evasion and money laundering scheme in 2017 were almost exclusively men. And male CEOs have been jailed for a variety of offenses over the years, such as tax evasion, securities fraud, theft, insider trading, investment mis-selling, and environmental crimes. Alongside these problems, boys and men tend to be disproportionately represented across a variety of other social ills. For example, British boys perform worse academically than girls. In almost every country, men are more at risk of committing self-harm and suicide. Men are more likely to suffer from drug, gambling, or alcohol addiction. Men have higher incarceration rates compared to women. Men are more likely to be the victim of violent crime, particularly in areas of high deprivation. Men take more risks in sex, driving, sports, outdoor pursuits, and a range of other activities. Men are less likely to seek out help for depression, anxiety, and stress. Men from socially disadvantaged backgrounds have poorer health outcomes in terms of disability, chronic illness, and injury rates compared to women in the same contexts. And men have a shorter life expectancy than women. Of course, whether these statistics are due to biological or sociological factors is an open question. Do men have a shorter life expectancy than women because they have a biological predisposition to higher cholesterol levels, for example, or is it because they pursue riskier behaviors, which are likely to lead to an earlier death? Do men pursue these risky behaviors because competition and bravado are so ingrained as part of the masculine ideal? Do boys perform academically poorer than girls because being clever is seen as less manly? Or are there neurological differences which explain this patterning? I return to some of these points in Chapter 2, but for the moment, it is enough to say that this division between biological and sociological explanations of gendered behavior has dominated the research literature for decades. Changing masculinities? Going beyond the statistics we've just discussed, it would be reasonable to say that the traditional touchstones of male identity, such as aggression and risk-taking, are becoming increasingly problematized, challenged, or disputed, although these cultural touchstones also vary depending on age, social class, and background. This is not new, though. Men's lives have long been changing, from the loss of traditional laboring jobs from the mid-1970s onward, and the subsequent rise of technical and non-manufacturing specialisms, through to the shift in sexual relations and changing familial and domestic patterns, which de-emphasize the role of the traditional male breadwinner. Even as far back as 1987, Shepherd Bliss, a key figure in the mythopoetic men's movement, claimed that the consensus about what it means to be a man in America today is eroding, a development that some applaud and others bemoan. In the mid-1980s through to the late 1990s, these men's movements, organizations, and consciousness-raising groups, influenced by writers like Robert Bly and Michael Mead, called for a return to a form of primal masculinity more connected to nature and spiritualism, drawing on storytelling, rituals, poetry, sports, and crafts. Such groups gave men the opportunity to gather together for friendship and connection and to reflect on the supposed changes that were affecting their lives. That said, the men's movement as a whole was firmly entrenched in the crisis of masculinity discourse, where the shifting sands of contemporary gender relations seemingly left men without a place in the world. Even though the men's movement more or less stalled in the late 1990s, it is, of course, worthwhile questioning the contention that men were, or are, in crisis, given the abundant social capital that is usually afforded to them. While a common refrain, it is difficult to sustain any argument that places men, especially white men, in a victim position, even if many do not feel they benefit from any degree of social privilege. I return to these issues in later chapters. As author John Scalzi points out in one of his blog posts, in the role-playing game known as the real world, straight white male is the lowest difficulty setting there is, and it is difficult to argue the contrary. Nevertheless, this crisis of masculinity discourse, which tends to center on white Western masculinities, is a beguiling one, and one that still crops up in contemporary discussions about men and their position in society. Drawing on this discourse, a variety of groups have pushed back against what they consider to be the ongoing demonization and marginalization of men, men who feel they are shunted to the sidelines. These groups include radical men's rights organizations, the newly coined predominantly male-led political alt-right movement, online seduction communities, individuals who identify as involuntary celibates or incels, that is, men who, despite wanting to, have never had sex and have not been in a sexual relationship with another person, and advocates of men going their own way, conventionally known as the MGTOW movement, that is, men who reject marriage, common law partnerships, and nuclear male-female relationships. Finding a home in the manosphere, a loose collection of male-authored websites and blogs concerned with men's issues, these groups promote the reclamation of a primal form of masculinity and a return to traditional gender norms and relations. By extension, many sites uphold an ideology of male supremacism, which sees women as biologically and intellectually inferior to men, incompetent, yet conniving and manipulative, reducing women to their reproductive function and simultaneously shaming women for having sex while believing that sex is something women owe men or that should even be coerced out of them. For example, Manosphere blogger Dariush Valizadeh, more commonly known as Roosh Valizadeh or Roosh V, argued that women should have their behavior and decisions overseen by close male relations. As long as we continue to treat women as equals to men, a biological absurdity that will one day be the butt of many jokes for comedians of the future, women will continue to make horrible decisions that hurt themselves, their families, and their reproductive potential. Unless we take action soon to reconsider the freedoms that women now have, the very survival of Western civilization is at stake. The post received over 450 responses, with the vast majority supportive of Valizadeh's points. A brief review of posts and user submissions on websites like The Red Pill, A Voice for Men, The Return of Kings, Men Going Their Own Way, and other Manosphere outlets provides numerous examples of men blaming women for the social ills that men face, coupled with anger about men's perceived loss of status and position. Unsurprisingly, views like this have led the Southern Poverty Law Center to classify certain male supremacist websites as extremist organizations. So why this book now? So why write a book about language and masculinities? What do we get by looking at this intersection of language and gender? What can a linguistic analysis uncover about contemporary social practices associated with men and masculinities? And what can this book offer in terms of furthering our knowledge about the mediated representations and lived realities of men in the 21st century? As noted previously, there has been an intense media spotlight on men and masculinities in recent years, including extensive discussion of their behavior, attitudes, beliefs, and ways of interacting with others. People are interested in and sometimes exasperated, frustrated, or angered by what men do. Over the past 10 years, a lot of ink has been spilled about toxic masculinities, fragile masculinities, aggressive masculinities, and other forms of masculine identities, while male violence against other men, as well as homophobic and transphobic violence perpetrated by men, have been raised as significant public health issues. Men are often cast as villains of the peace, while at the same time there is a general view that dominant ways of being a man are changing, and that the traditional strongholds of male identity are becoming unviable. Organizations such as the Men's Health Network and the Good Men Project are conscious of the social and psychological damage that these traditional expressions of masculinity can wreak, advocating for healthier configurations of masculinity. The quarrel about what it means to be a man plays out most dramatically in online media contexts, where people, mainly men, argue about how, for example, men are becoming more effeminate, or are losing their sense of masculine pride. This growing debate surrounding men and masculinities has been captured in a number of outputs directed at the general public. For example, artist Grayson Perry's documentary All Man and his companion book The Descent of Man offers an autobiographical account of Perry's life and his struggles to deal with normative conceptions of masculinity as he navigates his way through his own gender identity as a man in a dress. In a similar vein, comedian Robert Webb's 2017 autobiography, How Not to Be a Boy, examines the pressures men and boys are under to uphold certain standards of masculinity, Riley noting that the rules for being a man are straightforward. Don't cry, love sport, play rough, drink beer, don't talk about feelings. This idea of artifice and mask craft is also the subject of athlete Lewis Howe's The Mask of Masculinity, 2017, which deals with the intersection of masculinity and emotional vulnerability, with Howe contending that there are many things that our definition of masculinity inhibits, but the damage it does to our relationships and sense of self, and therefore to our chances of success in life, should be enough to make you reconsider the stereotypical definition of masculinity. Beyond these general public outputs, there is also a burgeoning academic scholarship on the topic, including a number of edited volumes and books dedicated to exploring the intersection between masculinities, cultures, and contexts. These include, to name just a few, Studying Men and Masculinities, Men, Masculinities, and Violence, Masculinities Under Neoliberalism, Marginalized Masculinities, Contexts, Continuities, and Change, Angry White Men, Gender Hate Online, Understanding the New Anti-Feminism, and Gender, Sexuality, and the Culture Politics of Men's Identities, alongside a host of journals about masculinity studies. So there is certainly no shortage of both academic and non-academic work on men and masculinities. But while this body of research forms an important foundation to some of the issues discussed later in this book, what is often missing from these accounts is any detailed treatment of the role language plays in how men construct their identities and how language functions as the primary channels through which they live their lives. And although there are a great many individual articles, edited volumes, and chapters concerned with language and masculinities, there are almost no single-authored books about the topic. Language and Mediated Masculinities, then, is one of the few book-length attempts at examining contemporary masculinities in the 21st century to answer the question of how language is implicated in the performance, maintenance, and construction of masculinities, focusing particularly on online and offline media contexts. More specifically, I believe that the critical study of language is central to a discussion about masculinity for several reasons. Why language? First, language is a key part of how people do identity, where linguistic resources are used to construct raced, sexed, gendered, and classed identities, and intersections thereof. Aspects of identity cannot easily be unlinked from one another. When people talk, they are not just communicating a particular idea or concept. They are telling their interlocutor or interlocutors about who they are and where they are from. Sometimes this can be their use of a certain word, phrase, or grammatical structure. Other times it can be the way that they say something. Whatever it might be, the way a speaker uses language gives other people broad information about their identity. This focus on language as a constituent component of identity has been a well-established part of sociolinguistic theory for over three decades, building on the pioneering work of Butler and Eckert and McConnell-Genet. I go into more detail about this in Chapter 2. But for the moment, it is enough to say that this approach views language as a social practice, as something people do as they go about their day-to-day lives. Thinking more specifically about men and masculinities, an in-depth analysis of language can help us better understand the linguistic means through which masculine gender identities are constructed and the different strategies men adopt to do masculinities. In the context of 21st century gender relations and the ways that masculinities are presented in online and offline spaces, it is vital that we know more about the role that language plays in these contemporary gendered identity projects. Second, we can use a linguistic analysis to examine how language is implicated in a broader system of social power and gender politics, how contemporary gender relations are constituted, and how the privileged position of men is maintained. This perspective also falls under the auspices of critical discourse analysis, where linguistics is used to uncover hidden or implicit systems of inequality. For example, although many aspects of everyday talk are typically unremarkable, they nevertheless yield incredible power, subtly influencing our decision-making, our worldviews, and our opinions. How people talk about one another and the words they use to refer to others can tell us a lot about the assumptions and expectations that are packed up alongside these terms. For example, the terms alpha and beta, commonly used within seduction communities as a way of ranking supposedly dominant and submissive men, are not only a way of identifying or claiming that an individual holds particular character traits, but they are also used as internal measures of hierarchy and difference, an example of what Christensen and Jensen called internal hegemony. Similarly, the term thought, or that ho or whore over there, has become a derogatory term within the manosphere to shame and belittle women for their sexual behavior, with those using it tapping into a broader set of discourses to do with often contrary standards of promiscuity and sexual attractiveness. Consequently, the study of language and masculinities can help uncover how different groups are marginalized and subjugated through linguistic means, including women, gay men, and ethnic minorities. This in turn can help us better understand the power dynamics which underpin gender relations. Finally, a linguistic analysis can shed light on normative notions of masculinity and how certain standards of masculinity are monitored, policed, and enforced. Men tell one another not to be fags or queer or pussies. Alphas and hard men are celebrated, while men who are bitches or betas or cucks are not real men at all. The more we know about what these standards are and how they are communicated through language, the more we are able to challenge the promotion of essentialist ideas about masculinity. The fact there are calls in some quarters for a return to traditional gender relations, such as women staying at home as caregivers, means that it is ever more important to chart where this is happening and connect it to broader processes of social change. Drawing on data collected from newspapers, social media sites, television programs, and online forums, this book presents a discussion of language and masculinities across a range of social and mediated contexts. In offering a critical evaluation of the intersection between language, masculinities, and identities in contemporary society, three key questions underpin the chapters. How are contemporary masculinities discursively constructed in both public and semi-public spheres? What can a linguistic analysis tell us about the representation and evaluation of masculinities in different media contexts? How does language create or recreate gender ideologies? And what might this language tell us about the state of contemporary gender relations? I consider these questions over the course of the book, and in typical academic fashion, the final chapter offers a comprehensive discussion of the implications of these questions, in addition to outlining future research directions. In taking a critical perspective on men and masculinities and the role that language plays in contemporary constructions of masculinities, the book adopts a data-driven approach throughout, drawing on critical discourse analysis, corpus linguistics, sociolinguistics, and other relevant analytical methods. Fair warning should also be given that a number of the textual examples used in this book articulate explicitly sexist, racist, and misogynistic positions. As Cameron shows, however, it is possible to arrive at two very different interpretations on the same piece of data, so it is likely that there will be disagreement about what the analysis shows, or even with my interpretation of what the data is telling us. Where possible, then, I have also used analytical triangulation, or the process of measuring or investigating a phenomenon from different perspectives. It should also go without saying that each chapter has been peer-reviewed by a number of colleagues in order to get a range of perspectives on what I have written. It is very easy to get wrapped up in one's own worldview and positionality when writing a book, so having outside eyes has been helpful in moderating my analytical process. Who is this book for? As might be imagined, the primary target audience of this book is other linguists, sociolinguists, and linguistic anthropologists, particularly those interested in language and masculinities, language, gender, and sexuality, language and identity, language and the media, linguistic variation, stylistics, corpus linguistics, and more. The book reveals how we can productively combine a variety of methodological approaches to develop a holistic picture of masculinities in the 21st century across different social and mediated contexts. The work presented in this book should also be of interest to researchers in the fields of anthropology, sociology, media, history, criminology, public policy, communication studies, and education. In particular, how we can better illuminate the lived reality of men through the analysis of language should find application across a range of disciplines to do with mediated performances of gender, intersectionality, and gender politics. I also hope to demonstrate how a richer understanding of masculinities can be developed through the application of insights drawn from across disciplines. I have also written this book with undergraduate and postgraduate students in mind, especially those taking classes in language, gender, and sexuality, sociolinguistics, and linguistic anthropology. The research presented in this book spans a range of contemporary contexts, including online forums, comedy shows, newspapers, and different social media sites, much of which I am anticipating listeners recognizing. What I want to demonstrate is that gender relations and the politics which undergird everything are out there in the here and now, ready to be picked apart and examined. I hope what follows might inspire students to reflect on the myriad ways that language is used to perform, enact, and construct different types of masculinity, and to consider how the findings in this book might help inform students' own projects and studies. Beyond academia, there is a growing interest in masculinities more generally, so I hope the book will also appeal to those looking to learn about language and masculinities and its relevance to their own experiences, including educational organizations, charities, policy groups, social workers, teachers, and parents, as well as those who have a broader interest in gender, masculinities, identity, and/or sociolinguistic research. I imagine that it is uncontroversial to say that we have all met boys or men in our past who did things we could not understand or said things that were sexist, hurtful, derogatory, or abusive. Conversely, I am sure we have all encountered men and boys who have stood out because they have not followed traditional or dominant ideas about what it is to be masculine. While I cannot claim to have any answers for why men do what they do, I hope that what is here will give listeners an insight into the current state of the field. Ultimately, I will always be in the dark about who bought this book and why. Whatever people's interest or motivation in choosing it might be, I hope that there is something of value within it for them. A few words from the author. Before going any further, though, I know that this book is likely to be polarizing, and that might even be an understatement, so it is worthwhile noting a few preliminary caveats. I hope that these points are taken in the spirit in which they are intended, which is to clarify some of the choices I have made and the underpinning motivations for the book. The first thing to say is that the predominant focus in the book is primarily on English-speaking, white, heterosexual, cisgendered men, rather than non-English-speaking and queer, homosexual, or non-white masculinities. And it would be reasonable to ask why, especially given recent work on gay masculinities, queer masculinities, female masculinities, and more. Milani discusses this point at length, arguing that the critical perspective on heterosexual men is necessary because, from the point of view of queer theory, we should not only pay attention to the cases in which bodies, relations, desires deviate from the norm, but also those cases in which they do not. The majority of the data I discuss in this book promotes a particular perspective on what it is to be a white man and what masculinity entails in 21st century society. Not only are these perspectives packaged up as normal and everyday, but those who deviate from them are often classed as not real men, lacking fundamental masculine qualities. Interrogating the lines between successful masculinity and failed masculinity is an important undertaking, which allows us to shake the profound foundations on which the gender and sexual orders are built. The second thing is that while I use men as a collective term in this chapter and elsewhere, partly for efficiency and partly for ease of listening, I do not mean to imply that what I discuss applies to all men, or even that all men do X, Y, or Z. Even this position needs some unpacking, though, because it dovetails with some of the counter-politics of the hashtag MeToo movement in late 2017 and early 2018, and the associated hashtag not all men backlash which accompanied it. Since the hashtag MeToo movement played out in the public arenas of Twitter, Facebook, and other social media sites, many men started asking what they could do as allies to reduce the rates of sexual abuse and harassment women were experiencing. Although this was a much welcome change from the blame the victim discourse that is popular in discussions of sexual violence toward women, a less savory strand of discourse emerged at the same time, that of not all men and the associated hashtag not all men. This statement was initially intended to highlight the fact that not all men were rapists, murderers, or likely to commit sexual assault or harassment, but understandably the general sentiment quickly came under fire as an attempt to divert the conversation away from the problems and issues faced by women. For example, Ford argues that not all men has become a notorious battle cry some men bellow whenever women start speaking about the impact misogyny has on our lives, while Proudfoot points out that the hashtag derails the conversation and twists the wave of women speaking up about street violence into man-hating. The murders of Sarah Everard and Sabina Nessa in 2021 further highlighted the continued problem of male violence toward women, and once again the specter of hashtag not all men trended across social media. While criticisms of the hashtag followed much the same lines as those expressed during the 2017 hashtag MeToo movement, there nevertheless appeared to be some shift toward men critically reflecting on their roles in sustaining cultures of male violence and privilege. To what extent this results in sustained and concrete change remains to be seen, but it represents at least tentative progress toward reframing violence against women as a men's issue rather than as a women's issue. As might be expected, I do not wish to align myself with the hashtag not all men position, but at the same time, I am conscious of following what Johnstone calls the grammar of particularity, or the need to distinguish particular observations from generalized speculations. Consequently, I try to make it clear when my discussion relates to specific communities of men, or even specific users, and when it is used in a more generic fashion, as far as is reasonably possible. The third point to note is that I do not think men are inherently bad, or that being a man is somehow the worst thing in the world. This book is not meant as an attack on men, and while criticizing certain forms of masculinity is often conflated with criticizing men, there is a marked distinction between men and masculinities. I discuss this distinction further in Chapter 2. But this distinction is not always observed, and very often men and masculinity are collapsed together. I would like to discuss just one brief example of this. In early 2019, shaving company Gillette released an advert challenging certain practices related to what has since come to be termed toxic masculinity, including bullying, casual sexism, and suppressing emotional vulnerability. The tagline of "The best a man can get," known by millions of men and teenage boys across the world, was reformulated to "the best that men can be," with the advert attempting to send a positive message that being a man does not mean having to beat others up or catcall women on the street. The reaction, however, was far from positive, with many men boycotting the company and criticizing the advert on social media. For example, at the time of writing, the advert has over 37.5 million views on YouTube and nearly 500,000 comments, with 840,000 thumbs up and 1.6 million thumbs down. There have also been accusations that Gillette were censoring comments and deleting downvotes to image manage and manipulate perceptions of the campaign. Incidentally, the video is now closed to comments. Perhaps the most high-profile opponent to Gillette's message was journalist and television presenter Piers Morgan. "I've used Gillette razors my entire adult life, but this absurd virtue-signaling PC guff may drive me away to a company less eager to fuel the current pathetic global assault on masculinity. Let boys be damn boys. Let men be damn men." Morgan's choice of words, including virtue signaling, global assault, and PC guff, has all the hallmarks of trivializing the message behind the advert. And, like Morgan, many men on social media viewed the advert as an attack on men, arguing that it was replete with harmful stereotypes and superficial characterizations of men as bullies and harassers. Commenting on Gillette's $8 billion write-down due to falling sales apparently caused by the advert, one YouTube poster argues that this is the price you pay for demonizing white male customers, while another states that gender equality activists making all the males feel bad about being who they are. I would argue, however, that these comments miss the point of the advert. The advert was not trying to stop boys being damn boys or men being damn men. It was instead trying to draw attention to some of the negative practices of what being a boy or a man normatively entails, and to promote positive, attainable, inclusive, and healthy versions of what it means to be a man. I do not think it is controversial to assert that bullying is bad, casual sexism is bad, or emotional detachment is bad. Nor do I think it is controversial to say that these are behaviors most commonly associated with boys and men, rather than with girls and women. The history of cinema, television, video games, literature, and advertising has innumerable examples of men doing exactly the kinds of practices flagged up in the Gillette advert, as does real life. In my reading, the advert was not implying that all men, or even most men, did these kinds of things. Far from it. Very often, though, these kinds of practices are bound up with expectations of what it is to be manly, be physically intimidating, objectify women, disavow your emotions, and it was this that Gillette was trying to dismantle. The point the advert was trying to make was that one can still be a boy or a man and avoid, challenge, or discourage these kinds of practices. As Ted Bunch, co-founder of the charity A Call to Men, pointed out, the advert wasn't an indictment on men. It's actually an invitation to men to be different, to be better. Men have been challenged to reflect, to challenge our privilege, our entitlements, to look at how we impact other people. In the same way, this book is not meant to suggest that all men are awful, terrible people, or that being a man is an awful, terrible thing, and it should not be taken as a manifesto against men and masculinities. Full disclosure, I am a man, and I enjoy being one, although I am conscious that this enjoyment is concomitant with certain privileges I have based on my sex, my sexuality, my social class, my ethnicity, my language, and more. But my identity as a man does not mean that I cannot cast a critical eye on particular forms of contemporary masculinities or how some of the practices traditionally associated with masculinity are problematic or should be challenged. As such, I would argue that not everything associated with men and masculinities should be viewed negatively. Consequently, some of the chapters deal with what could be regarded as the more positive aspects of masculinity studies, including male friendship, caregiving, fatherhood, and homosociality. I also spend some time talking about how masculinity is being reconfigured and reformulated, and the role that charity organizations are taking on to promote different and arguably healthier conceptualizations of masculinity. Of course, it is worthwhile mentioning that considering the positive side of masculinity might be considered problematic, especially given how men are often bound up with systems of power, hierarchy, and inequality, and the extent to which white heterosexual men in particular benefit from what Connell calls the patriarchal dividend. As Englar Carlson and Kaselica note, for many individuals, the idea of empowering men or identifying strengths may seem foreign or downright antithetical to someone who is working to reduce male power, privilege, and sexism. A central concern could be that advocating for a positive psychology of men, or positive masculinity, may gloss over the dark side of masculinity and may be associated with supporting patriarchal structures. My aim in including chapters oriented around positive masculinities is not an attempt to rehabilitate men, to advance a both sides of the story angle, or to provide some naive sense of balance. Instead, I suggest that we cannot fully understand the more troublesome components of masculinity without interrogating those practices that are more broadly concerned with positive or progressive outlooks. If what it is to be a man in the 21st century is based on a state of tension, then we need to examine the different components that construct this tension. But perhaps more important, these parts of male life and experience are hugely under-investigated in language and masculinities studies. If we are serious about expanding the scope of the field, then these are the kinds of areas that need attention. Who am I to write this book? In most academic books, the author's background is normally left out, usually for good reason. Some people do not feel comfortable putting that much of themselves into the public eye, or are wary of giving up too much information about themselves in case of doxing, that is, personal or private information being released into the public domain, while others think that it is irrelevant to the main focus of the book. In sociolinguistics and linguistic anthropology, however, there has been a shift toward more explicitly stating one's positionality. This is not born from a desire to engage in useless navel-gazing, but rather to demonstrate that academic work is never neutral and is shaped by the author's life history and lived experiences. As Spiliotti and Tagg note in their discussion of online ethics, researchers should be more explicit about their positionality, agenda, perspective, and ideologies. As such, it would be foolhardy of me to claim that this book is an objective account. No academic work is, even though the hard sciences might disagree. I'll be honest, though. Putting myself out there like this has caused me some sleepless nights, and I am not sure how I feel with all of this being written down. At the very least, I hope it gives listeners some sense of who I am and where this book comes from, even if it is not an especially interesting account of my history. So, who am I? Like most introductions, I should probably start with my name. I am Rob, although I grew up as Robert, and did not really start using Rob until I was in my late 20s in an attempt to reinvent myself after a breakup. My parents still call me Robert, and it is what I use as my publishing and professional name, but most of my colleagues, students, and friends know me as Rob. Whether it is Rob or Robert, I was born in Scotland in 1982, which makes me the ripe old age of 40 at the time this book came out, firmly in the middle age bracket of life. I had a largely uneventful childhood growing up in a small Scottish village before moving to a larger town of around 13,000 when I was 8. Both my mum and my dad are from traditional working-class backgrounds and wanted me to have a better life than them when I grew up. I had a positive male role model in the form of my dad, who worked as a stonemason for the local council and then latterly as a roads and lighting inspector, while my mum worked a variety of jobs in the local community and instilled in me the importance of hard work, persistence, and discipline. I enjoyed reading all through primary and high school, and I really did not like sports, although this changed when I realized that it was possible to enjoy sports as a spectator rather than as an active participant, fighting, whether play or real, or getting dirty running around outside, all typical pursuits for most young boys in the central belt of Scotland. Consequently, I was a bit of an outsider and was bullied when I was younger, especially in high school, both for rejecting stereotypical boy activities and for daring to engage with the learning process the school represented. In Paul Willis's terms, who wrote the classic 1977 sociological text Learning to Labor, I would have been an earol, the studious, obedient pupil who followed the rules and did his homework. Thankfully, I found a group of friends with whom I shared some interests, particularly video games and movies, which helped take the sting out of the worst of the bullying. In 1994, I joined the Air Training Corps, an affiliation which started me down the path of wanting to join the RAF. Unfortunately, I was diagnosed with exercise-induced asthma in 1999, which put the brakes on those plans. My teachers and parents encouraged me to come up with an alternative, and I decided to do a degree in English literature at the University of Glasgow. I was the first in my family to go to university, with the aim of becoming a teacher. During university, though, literature and I had a falling out, and I found surprising solace in linguistics, which ended up being my main focus, alongside a wee dabble in Scottish literature. Throughout my studies, I had a range of jobs, including a trainee electrician, a cashier at Summerfield, a now-defunct supermarket some UK-based listeners will recognize, a customer service representative at the Glasgow Science Centre, and a summer camp counselor in America. So I would like to think I had fairly broad exposure to a variety of people, cultures, and ideas. I finished my undergraduate degree in 2004, but not before being jumped, or assaulted for those unfamiliar with the vernacular of casual street violence, by a group of young men as I was on my way to the gym one Friday evening. Thankfully, that story has a happy ending, in that I was not seriously injured, and the encounter ultimately inspired my postgraduate research on language, masculinity, and violence. As might be expected, though, it was pretty scary at the time, and I genuinely thought I was going to be stabbed or worse. As it was, I only got a belt buckle whipped across my face, a few punches, and a good story to tell. I finished my MPhil in 2005 and my PhD in 2009 before being offered a post as a lecturer at Birmingham City University, where I have been ever since. Now, as if all that was not personal enough, here's a bit more. Over the course of my life, I have lived in Scotland, England, America, and Finland, sometimes with people, sometimes by myself. I have tried, unsuccessfully, to learn German, Spanish, and French, but I have had better success with Italian. I am generally politically apathetic, but would class myself as left-leaning. I enjoy movies, gaming, beer, whiskey, cycling, rugby, running, when my knees let me, barbecuing, and reading. I have identified as a Scottish, white, cis-hetero male all my life, or at least since I was able to articulate that kind of thing. I would probably categorize myself as middle class now, but I cannot say I like the label. I have had three serious relationships, met my wife at a music festival in 2009, and we married in 2015. So why am I telling you all of this? As though this is a bad daytime talk show rather than a serious academic book. It is not just to pad things out or add to the word count, honestly. Instead, it is to prove to you that this book is the product of all of the experiences I have had over the course of the past 40 years. It has not always been an easy life, nor has it been sheltered, but it has certainly not been as difficult as it could have been. And all of these experiences have undoubtedly influenced my gender identity in adulthood. I do not like violence or confrontation. I do not enjoy taking risks. I do not like being a leader or an alpha. And I do not like dominating people or winning. At the same time, I am aware that I embody certain aspects of identity which put me at a social advantage. I am university educated. I am white. I am male. I am straight. I am middle class. I am English speaking. In some circles, I would probably be described as a brainwashed soy boy beta cuck. What these terms mean will be covered in later chapters. I also wanted to write this history to demonstrate that I am a real person, just like your brother, friend, father, son, nephew, spouse, or colleague. And I say this because, and this might be the paranoia talking, it is likely there will be listeners out there who will disagree with what I have to say, who will argue that I have been bought off by a shadowy organization to write this book, or who will see it as part of some left-wing feminist conspiracy to undermine Western masculinity. Part of me is worried, naturally, by any potential backlash, because I have dared to question some of the less salubrious aspects of masculinity, especially as this pertains to digital spaces. And unfortunately, I do not think this concern is misplaced. Having spoken with other colleagues who have received hate mail and online harassment following publication of work critical of particular constellations of masculine practice. Disagreement is to be expected in academia. But I would argue that trolling, harassment, doxing, and personal abuse have no place in the canon of civil discourse. Yet I have been online for far too long to know that these practices are common and hugely damaging tools in the armory of online argumentation and can have irrevocable consequences for those who find themselves in the firing line. Call me ridiculous, but I could do without all of that in my life. That does not make me a snowflake. It just makes me human. For what it is worth, I have not been brainwashed by some radical liberal philosophy that has blinded me to the way that the real world works. I am just a lad who grew up in a small town in Scotland who wanted to write a book I thought was important. Whatever your political or personal philosophies are, I hope you will engage with the book in the spirit it is intended. Outline of this book. Before finishing this chapter, I want to set out a synopsis of each chapter to introduce the data, methodological approaches, and underpinning frameworks used in the book. My aim here is to outline the structure of the book and the general focus of each chapter so listeners know what is coming and how it all fits together. In Chapter 2, I discuss a number of key terms used throughout the book, including sex, gender, men, and masculinity, alongside setting out some of the history of masculinity's studies and the trajectory of language and masculinity's research over the past 20 years. This chapter aims to contextualize the book against existing research trends and explain how the analysis chapters contribute to our understanding of the intersection of language, gender, and sexuality. Chapter 3 sets out the methodological and theoretical nuts and bolts, which underpin the analyses presented in Chapters 4 through 8. Chapter 3 also presents an overview of the ethical and legal dimensions of the study and issues relating to managing researcher safety. Chapter 4 is the first of the analytical chapters and offers a discussion of one of the exemplars of tough masculinity in Britain, that of the hard man. Tracing how discourses of tough masculinity are deployed in two British broadsheet newspapers, the chapter investigates how the figure of the hard man is used across the different domains of entertainment, sports, politics, and true crime. Chapter 5 considers a more contemporary context in the form of r/TheDonald, an online community on the social media site Reddit, to examine the intersection of right-wing masculinities and nationalism. Drawing on four subcorpora, the chapter charts the range of normative masculinities which exist on the subreddit and discusses how these are connected to notions of protectionism and national identity. Chapter 6 turns to the broader scope of the manosphere and considers data collected from four Reddit manosphere communities. More specifically, the chapter discusses the concept of toxic masculinity and examines how men and women are represented in these communities and what these representations tell us about the nature of online gendered hierarchies. Chapter 7 discusses the concept of positive masculinity and looks at how masculinity in the 21st century is being reconfigured away from the more extreme practices related to toxic masculinity. This chapter also presents an analysis of the comedy show Brooklyn Nine-Nine to explore how television can challenge hegemonic notions of masculinity, particularly in the realms of homosociability, friendship, and non-romantic same-sex affiliation. Chapter 8 examines fatherhood and masculinity through the analysis of dad.info, an online forum dedicated to all aspects of fatherhood and parenting. Examining discourses of new fatherhood, this chapter contributes to the growing body of literature which falls under the umbrella of Fatherhood 2.0 research. Finally, Chapter 9 discusses some broader implications of the book, outlines what we might learn from the insights the book has offered, and relates the book to the general scope of men and masculinities research. It also imagines some of the potential future research trajectories in the field. Conclusion. In addition to outlining the contribution this book makes to current debates about men and masculinities, this chapter has attempted to situate the book within a broader context of contemporary gender politics. As I hope I have been able to articulate, this book is timely given the reestablishment of traditional, or masculine, gender values among the newly coined alt-right and manosphere movements, recent media coverage of sexual abuse and harassment carried out by high-profile men in the political and entertainment spheres, and the argument that Western society has reverted to an age of aggressive masculinity. Against a backdrop of rising neoliberalism, ethnic nationalism, online radicalization, and fractious gender relations, not only is a critical discussion about masculinities much needed, but the increased attention on the politics of identity, sexuality, class, power, and more, all refracted through the lens of gender, means that there is a moral imperative to examine contemporary masculinities and how language is implicated in the construction, maintenance, and mediation of such masculinities. It is only by doing so that we can start to unpack the kinds of discourses which surround men and masculinities, and to better understand the usually hidden processes of hierarchy, differentiation, and discrimination. I hope this book represents one small step in that direction. Chapter 2. Setting the Scene. Some Key Ideas in Language and Masculinity Studies. Introduction. In this chapter, I introduce the theoretical foundations on which the rest of the book is built. To that end, the chapter has four main purposes. First, it offers a discussion of some key terms used throughout the book, including sex, gender, men, male, and masculinity. While the meaning of these terms might seem obvious, they have in fact been the subject of some contestation in the literature. Second, it describes some of the approaches in the study of men and masculinities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.